Hello, everyone. Today, I'm happy to introduce my colleague, Professor Aniket Kate. He joined the computer science department as an assistant professor in fall of 2015. Before joining Purdue, Aniket was a faculty member and an independent research group leader at Saarland University, where he was heading the cryptographic systems research group. He completed his PhD from the University of Waterloo in 2010. And did a postdoc at Max Planck Institute till 2012. Today, Aniket will be talking about the Internet of Value. Over to you.
Thank you. So, hello everybody, and thanks for coming for this talk. I see some familiar faces or some unfamiliar faces. So, this is a talk I'm going to talk about generally interesting projects that we are doing in the space of cryptocurrencies, blockchain, which generally is coming these days with a very nice name called Internet of Value. So during the talk, anytime you if you have any question, please feel free to stop me. Okay? So in particular, we'll be focusing on challenges regarding privacy and the some interesting applications of this whole field. So we are seeing over the, like after the explosion of internet or whatsoever, we are seeing a ever-changing space of communication. We still have most of our communication for other than just our emails, we were still doing them locally, like hiring a taxi or getting an agent for to rent an apartment or whatsoever. But from 2010 up to 2000, like by the last decade, we started to see globalization of all this process in the form of we buy things, almost all our things online. We pay for things. When we connect to our friends, we connect them via Facebook. Whenever we want to find out a place, rather than just looking for a hotel, maybe I'll go for Airbnb. So all those solutions that we started to see. But still, all of them were based central. There was one company who is organizing and who is maintaining all this information, maintaining all the reputations, who was controlling everything. And we rely on them for the correctness and the trustworthiness of all information. What we started to observe in 2010 onwards is that maybe we can also decentralize this whole process. Okay? Rather than relying on single entity or single governing party, maybe we have something like decentralized and distributed environment. Initially, it started as something for the payments, where rather than relying in the form of Bitcoin, where rather than relying on a single entity to perform transactions, we can now employ this Bitcoin, which does not rely on single party. The value of it doesn't depend upon a single governmental entity, or it can be also regulated in a more general, more generic and more decentralized fashion. And what we want to see now is that maybe we can move away from this only payment network only and basically use such as the environment, which we typically now use a term called blockchain for everything, including all the things that we saw here for finding where if I'm buying a particular product, if I want to make sure that how that product actually reached me, okay, is the cheese that I'm buying is actually Swiss cheese. Okay, so we can indeed use all this decentralized environment to actually get guarantees which are distributed and decentralized. And indeed, that's certainly something which excites me. And we can typically say now that maybe Bitcoin or some of these currency may not survive. They have their own issues to somewhere or other. However, this whole concept of blockchain and its applicability is here to stay. And today we are going to see some of the applications of that in the payment domain as well as outside. So this is just showing another graphic here that how the whole investment and the whole interest in this field is growing. I mean, there was until 2040 only few players in this space, while today, as we see, this is also slightly older things. I mean, we are seeing many more players with much more investment in this space, and you can see all the big players now coming in picture in this setting. And this is just showing the whole startup industry here. There are just so many startups working in all different environments. So this is a live area, not only in the academics, but also in the industry where there are several players trying to develop all very interesting solutions. So this all started with something called Bitcoin. And in this talk, first I'll start explaining what is Bitcoin. In principle, I'll just give a very small and crisp introduction what is necessary for our discussion today. Then we will look into an interesting application of such a system outside the payment industry, in particular to non-disclosure agreement. Followed by that, I'll talk about the privacy challenge with such a system for cryptocurrencies such as Bitcoin, as well as some other entities such as credit networks. And I'll end up giving a small slide talking about very interesting challenges that I find interesting. This is just a very small list, and there are just so many things that you can do here, but we'll just look at some of those, okay? So how the way to look at Bitcoin, indeed, is that it's a cryptocurrency. So it based inherently based on a cryptographic concept of digital signature. Let's say here, our Alice, she wants to pay to somebody, Bob, some, let's say, one Bitcoin in this scenario. What she does is she basically creates a signed transaction saying that I want to give, out of the 70 Bitcoin that she got, she wants to give one Bitcoin to Bob. And that's what I'm showing there on the top, where the value go from A to B. And the rest of the money after this transaction get back to me and goes to my another wallet. Okay? And she's just basically going to take this transaction, sign it with her signature scheme, and send that to the network. What the network does is that it creates a blockchain. It creates, keep on collecting these transactions that users are performing, combine them in blocks, which are basically a set of transactions that happen in a time period and agreed by the network. And they keep on appending this block to the existing network. And that's how you create such a chain of transactions or the chain of blocks. And that's the reason we call this as a blockchain. Okay? And the idea is that once you see your transaction in the blockchain, or once the receiver Bob sees that transaction is indeed in the blockchain, for some time it knows that it's going to remain there, and now it knows that indeed the money belongs to this person, Bob. So that's a way we can take the concept from the cryptography and try to use that towards money in this particular form. And that's the only way we perform here. There is no real transaction involved. All things are just determined by this blockchain and the digital signatures. As it turns out, there are several interesting things we can study here, like how these blockchains are formed, what can we do with these digital signatures. But I like to, for our talk, bring the attention to an interesting concept there, which we call as smart contracts. Okay, or maybe we can just call them as a contract. So when this particular transaction gets added to the system, there is a small script that has to run, which says that you're going to calculate whether the input value for a transaction, which was $70 on the previous slide, you're going to check the output value. They should match. The signature should actually match the signature that is provided by the user, and it should be valid signature. We are going to check all these things. And for that, they have developed a small scripting language. Okay, but as it turns out, we can introduce interesting more opcodes to this system language and add more business logic to such a system. And that's what the concept of smart contract is. So the concept is that because these transactions are inherently executed by themselves, so we can call these as self-executing scripts or program that directly control the transfer of the digital cash based on certain conditions. Okay, so it's like a contract can be between multiple participants, but for simplicity, we're going to assume that it's just between two participants. Okay, and the contract can be like based on some conditions, some things will happen, otherwise something else will happen. And we are going to see examples of that soon. But the key concept with the contracts is that they are self-imposable, because whatever written in there, anybody can take this contract and execute that based on the well-defined input and output behavior from this contract. The second thing is they are trustless, because now we are working in a system where this everything is maintained by the network and not individual. We do not need to trust an individual person. As it turns out, similar to the Bitcoin, it also is faster and cheaper, because we do not need anybody to execute your transaction or contract. And they are faster because of the speed that is with which the transaction are accepted in Bitcoin. It allows you also to get the speed. So indeed, these Bitcoin smart contracts is certainly very interesting things, and people are also developing other more interesting systems for the smart contract. So there are various interesting examples that one can develop based on smart contract, and I just thought of giving some few basic examples. Let's say you want to crowdfund a project. But you do not want to give away your money until there are enough other players or enough other participants who want to give the money so that that particular project can start. So this can be a contract. where you the transaction only starts when there is enough players and with enough money in the system. Otherwise, your money remains with you. That's one example of contract. You can also aim for fair exchange, where if I give something to somebody, that other person should give the other thing back to me. If they don't agree with the contract, or if they don't do that, they will lose money. So contracts can be have such interesting business logic that is included in this. I also gave a talk last year, which we with something called non-equivocation contract, which says that you should not make different statements in different contexts. If you or in same context, you should not make different statements. If you do that, then you will be held accountable for that. So there are various interesting examples for the contracts. And today, what we are going to see is another example, which is something which I assume some of you have already heard about. It's called non-disclosure agreement. So this non-disclosure agreements or NDA is a very common thing in the industry, which allows you to two participants to share some documents, mostly from one person to other person, such that this other person can use the information in those documents, but they should not reveal that to the rest of the world. Okay, so these things come as name as confidentiality agreement, proprietary information agreement in all these different names. And what happens is that many times these agreements get breached, and there are so many examples. Even when we just provide our password and username to a system so that they can allow us to log in, in principle, they should not reveal this password, but they reveal it. And there are like even bigger examples. You might have heard about this French military manufacturers, and which they recently had these new submarines called Scorpion, and the document regarding that got leaked by some third party who was supposed to keep them secure. So the breaches of this kind are extremely common. What do you do there? And basically, when you have any such breach in the NDA, you require some arbiter, some trusted party who actually should take care of that indeed there's a breach happen, and then respectively maybe have some legal option or some monetary issues so that the person who's who has suffered the document loss has get either monetarily paid or otherwise. What we want, and in this case, as we can see here, I'm just drawing the same thing in a more pictorial fashion. So we typically in an NDA, we have a sender and a receiver, where sender is sending a confidential document to the receiver, which receiver is should keep the private. Okay, and let's say somehow receiver, if she reveals this document to the to the world via unauthorized sharing, then what you want is that somehow the sender can actually create sender can actually go after such a receiver, talk to their lawyers, communicate with the law and authority, and make these receivers accountable for what they did. Okay. But as it turns out, this process of using lawyers and the law authority is time consuming, and as well as it's resource intensive. You have to spend significant amount of time and payment to get this done. So what we aim for is that, can we do anything for this this expensive and time consuming process so that we can use these contracts to actually make this process faster and cheaper? So what we think of here as a solution is that maybe we can have some kind of interesting time lock deposit. So the idea for such a time lock deposit will be, it provides the receiver a confidential document with a primary incentive to keep this maintain this hidden or don't disclose it. If they do that, then there will be they will lose some money which they have kept aside separately in a deposit. Okay, in generally, what we want is that what will happen here is that the sender and the receiver will create a contract where the receiver puts money into this some time lock deposit, such that this deposit contract will include secrets from both the participants. Okay, after the timeout, which typically we expect to be large, the deposit money will return to the receiver who created the contract. But instead, somehow, if magically the sender receives the secret that is provided by the receiver, then it can take this secret and withdraw the money anytime, even before this time lock. And the question will always hinge that that if the receiver reveals the document, it should be possible for sender to obtain the secret of the receiver so that then he can get the money. So the way we do that is we use a combination of some well-known tools in cryptography, most watermarking and obvious transfer, such that when the sender is sending a document to receiver, it's going to create some various versions of that, okay? And receiver is going to pick one version, which will explicitly associate itself with the secret that it has that it is going to associate with this particular time lock deposit. So the sender is going to create several copies. The receiver is going to pick one of them, okay? Based on that's what it is done with the concept of obvious transfer. So at the end of this protocol, sender has no idea which version receiver got, but it knows that one of the version it got, okay? And then idea will be once this exchange has happened, afterwards when the receiver, let's say, reveal this document to the other world, now by looking at the document, the sender can know what which version or which of those earlier version is the one which is used by the receiver or which is published by the receiver. As the receiver only got one version, it cannot cheat, okay? And sender cannot even cheat because out of lots of versions that are created by sender, receiver just picked one. So it has no idea which one it picked, okay? So that way both parties are hold accountable until something is wrong done by the receiver, all right? And once that receiver publishes a document, sender will have a very simple process to determine what was the private key or what was the secret that receiver put in the contact. And then it can just obtain that, open the deposit and get this money. Okay, so this way, in scenarios where we don't require an arbiter or legal process, we can associate a deposit of money with a non-disclosure agreement.
Question is about if there are two receivers, do they receive two different copies of the secret? Because one of them can leak, then how do I know which one of them leaked?
Yeah, that's
because
it.
I can deduct money from both in that case.
Excellent question. So the question was just because the mic was not on, is that what if you have multiple receivers? Okay. Currently, the way we are defining that that will be individual contract between one sender and one receiver. But it's a very interesting, still manageable challenge to actually extend this to the whole system where you have simultaneous multiple receivers of the whole system. And with this, we come very close to the concept of trader tracing. So indeed, it's possible, but currently the focus is just, we're going to assume that there'll be separate contract for each receiver, okay? Good, so this is like a brief overview of what we did in this solution. Now we'll move on and try to look at some other aspects regarding this. The one of them is the privacy challenges that we all these systems and cryptocurrencies have with them. So we already saw that we have sender Alice and she was sending money to Bob and the return money she gets back in her another address, okay? She can also replace that A prime, which is basically her new address or the new wallet, with her individual wallet. Okay, but as it turns out, anybody, for let's say this example that I'm showing here, there are two coins. One went to the Bob, and other returned to the other address of Alice. Okay, this process can repeat based on with several transactions, as I'm showing here, where we Alice start with one wallet. She gives some money to one Bob, then all the return came to A prime address. Then again, it is transferred to some other Carol. The remaining came to again A double prime. And again, some other more money sent to Dave, and the remaining came to A triple prime. Anybody who can see all this log, which is public, because it's in the blockchain, which is a public environment, can easily associate that the four addresses, A, A prime, A double prime, A triple prime, all belong to the same person, okay? Now, eventually, if they somehow are able to associate any of these addresses with Alice, her own identity in the physical world, they know all the transactions that are performed by Alice, where the money is, and they can maybe, if she earns a lot of money, they may also go after her, not only to just break her anonymity, but also get this money, because basically get this money by stealing the private key. So this linkability is a huge issue in all these systems because of the general public nature of all these logs and blockchains, okay? So as it turns out, there are just several attacks that have come on such a system, and this is just two examples. I mean, one example they were able to, this is from 2013, so quite old, but they are still able to associate all the important transactions that were present at that time in Bitcoin and associate with them several entities that are present. And in that way, they know the transaction volume, who paid to whom what, in all entirety. Okay. They also push button services, which basically allow you to basically click, put some information and get whatever statistics or whatever information that is known for those IP addresses, which is bit iodine. So that's all such de-anonymization services are possible, and it's a huge challenge in all this new space. So towards working towards solution, we started to look into the possibilities that are available to us. And the way to solve this de-anonymization problem is to use some kind of an anonymous communication system to actually make this transaction unlinkable to each other. Okay? Very briefly, there are three different kind of a solution that present in such systems: mixing network, onion routing, and the dynamic cryptographer networks. Among these, the first two, the mixing network and onion routing, inherently assume some set of semi-trusted nodes which are providing you the anonymity. They are basically proxy for you. Okay? Instead, the dynamic cryptographer is a system where it's just the participant who want to actually get the privacy, who want to get the anonymity, they come together and perform the transaction together, such that eventually they get the benefit without requiring any third party. Given that the whole blockchain concept has the inherent assumption that we do not want any trusted third party, this concept is certainly much more coherent and consistent with the way Bitcoin way of thinking, or the cryptocurrency way of thinking. So that's what we did, and the idea is that we want to achieve solutions for this linkability problem. And in particular, we want what we'll call as P2P protocol. That means a protocol which only and explicitly employ peer-to-peer communication without no third party, and solve the privacy issues with the public verifiability of this blockchain or public availability of this blockchain. So what dynamic cryptographer kind of a network can allow you is that, assume that a protocol which allows participants to provide inputs, such that at the end of that, you're going to summation of all those inputs. Let's say those are plain numbers, let's say everybody input a random number in some range, or some number of their choice. What the protocol is going to provide you in the end is a summation of all these numbers. Okay? However, in our case, we do not want summation. What we want is that we have different transactions or we have different requirements for the participant, and we want to mix these messages. So let's say there were different transactions for all these participants, and we want to basically mix them together with each other. Okay? So the message M1 went somewhere else, M2 went somewhere else after the mixing. And the protocols to do such things are already known in the literature. Some of them were providing such a system. And the two prominent examples for this is Decent and CoinShuffle, which basically are extremely close to each other. However, this whole process of mixing this transaction was requiring the number of rounds that is linear in the number of peers. That means if you have four participants, you have to wait for four communication rounds. If you have 100 participants, you have to wait for 100 rounds. And that can be onerous, or that can be problematic in real world scenario. Let's say if you want to participate 100, if you have 100 participants, maybe your protocol will take some minutes, maybe 10 minutes. That is too slow for the real world. So instead, what we want to achieve is that we want to reduce this and make it only constant time, such that all this shuffling that we saw happens much faster. Okay? If you have some guys who are malicious, this just increases even further, that where you require much more time than earlier. So as we already know, what dynamic cryptographer provides us is a very interesting way, so that if my message is M1 and the other guy's message is M2, we combine them together and we get output as M1 plus M2. Okay? What if we have two participants, and instead of sending one message, we send two messages? We send M1 and I also send M square, and the other participants send M2 and M square, or M2 square. Okay? Now, if we do two of these things simultaneously, what we'll get output as is message M1 plus message M2, and second output will be message M1 square plus message M2 square. Okay? Now, given this equation, we can solve this equation to obtain the values of M1 and M2. Okay? And we can obviously extend this for any number of value of n, and basically replace such a system for just values of m1, m2. We can take message m1, m2 up to mn, and respectively have m1 square, m2 square, mn square, and so on, such that we can get the whole system. Like when you have n participants, we can have n simultaneous message from them. We combine all of them together, and basically we solve this equation sum to obtain these all these values m1 to mn in a shuffled form. Okay? So at the end of the protocol, we basically get all these summation of mi, summation of mi squares, and we solve this system, and we get the individual values of m, which is our initial goal. All right, and this we can allow, this concept is called as Newton's identity, and which allows you to us to obtain the values m1 to mn in a some shuffled fashion. Okay, and as all these communications are happening simultaneously in the all these, basically all these n messages are sent simultaneously, the number of rounds that we required is only one. Okay. So this way we can perform the shuffling that is required for the transaction in the constant number of rounds. And even when we have some of these participants malicious, we will only have that in the linear in the number of participants. That's for the basics that I wanted to cover for the peer-to-peer mixing and its application, that how we can employ that for mixing the Bitcoin. So once we are able to mix such transaction, we can combine those transactions together and obtain the effect so that you don't know who sent money to whom. Okay, so there we have like participant A1 to AN, and they have recipient B1 to BN, and all of the transactions happen together, so you do not know whether A1 talked to A B1 or A1 talked to BN. And we get all this combination, and that's the one which provides us the privacy that is required for the transactions. Now moving on, the next thing that we are going to see now is an interesting concept in this whole setting called IOU credit networks. So let's start it to look at in a scenario where maybe there are two participants who want to perform a transaction, but they do not have a currency in common. Okay, so what they can do instead is that they can assume that maybe they just create a link so that eventually they will settle this via some mean or other. Okay, let's say Bob and Alice, and Bob has to pay Alice. Okay, Bob has given some service to Alice for $100. Now Alice does not have money to immediately pay to Bob. Instead, what she can provide Bob is a signature saying that I owe you $100. Okay, we can have similar system. That where basically in a credit network representation, we are going to represent this whole thing as a link going from Alice to Bob with an arrow for 100. Okay, correspondingly, we can let's say we have Dave and Carol, and Dave and Carol went for a hike with Alice and Bob. Okay, now we can see in this system is that Dave gave gave a meal or something to Carol which cost $10. Now Carol actually owes Dave this $10, but Carol is just going to say that, look Dave, we both are not going to meet each other anytime in the future. So how we settle this transaction? So what they can do here is that they can know that they know both Alice and Bob together. So what they can do is that they can use this trust between Alice and Bob, which is already present. And so that now instead of Carol directly owing Dave $10, she can use this path via Alice and Bob so that now she will owe Alice $10. Alice will now owe Bob more, that is 10, 100, 100 which was already present, plus 10 that already got added. And Bob will now owe Dave $10. And in this way, they can settle this transaction that they wanted to perform. With the hope that eventually Alice and Carol, they are going to see each other in the future, and they can use this link to settle this transaction. Okay? So that's the concept of credit network. So the credit network, the idea is that whenever you have any payment or any settlement that you need to perform for any transaction, instead of actually paying that the money, you search for the paths on the network, which basically all these paths are IOU paths. It's similar to that. You try to settle among yourself just by, rather than paying money, instead of using the previous debt to settle those payments. So I'm showing an example here. Let's say here Bob, and Bob needs to pay Carol $15. What can happen is that Bob can try to search the path from Bob to Carol and check if that all those paths have the enough credit on that. And the paths over here will be these two paths, okay, which has enough credit. So they are going to perform the transaction such that the values will be respectively reduced. So basically, the link from Bob to Carol will become from 5 to 0, and all the other path which goes via Eve and Dave to Carol, that will also reduce by the value 10. So that now they have settled a transaction of $15. So this is now a slightly different domain than actual cash payment, which was the case in Bitcoin, something like that. Here you want to settle everything via the pre-existing debt. And then your hope is that whenever possible, you try to reduce the debt in the system. If it is not possible, you introduce new edges. Okay, that's the whole concept regarding this credit network. And it provides interesting opportunities along with something which is already possible with Bitcoin. So what it allows in this way is that it allows you to perform transactions which are in a manner such which is flexible and robust, so that you settle the transaction via transitive trust and links. And if something wrong has happened in such a system, the loss will be also bounded. What I mean by that is that, let's say here, Eve decide to actually disobey or disallow the transaction which she actually should allow. In that case, the amount of incorrectness that can happen in the system is explicitly limited by the amount of trust or amount of IOUs that Eve has obtained from the other network. So in principle here, if we see Alice and Bob, basically they are trusting Eve for the $10 and $20 respectively. And that's the only badness that they can happen, because now all this liquidity that, or all this trust that, or all this IOU that they have provided to Eve, she will just deny to use it or employ that in wrong fashion. But another thing is that the trust that she is putting on other guys is worthless, because by that she just making, or by that IOU trust that she is putting, is basically just making her more the part of the system, and more even if she decide to disobey that, we have nothing to lose in the system. So in principle, this boundedness can have interesting applications, and that's the scenario that along with the payment system, it can be also used for something like Sybil resistant applications, in the sense that rather than in your distributed network, the things that can go wrong, instead of depending them on the number of bad participants in your system, now that instead will depend on the bad links in your systems. Okay, so for example, the example I'm showing here, the left hand side are good participants, and the right hand side we have bad participants, and there can be any number of bad participants, but the amount of things that may go wrong is explicitly determined by the trust that is provided by the good participants to the bad participants. Okay, so it's similar to the social network, where you are typically assumed to have good friends, the friends that you know, these are the real people. Okay, and the things that only go wrong when you actually make friend with somebody else who is a Sybil node or a malicious node, and actually infiltrated your network and your friend's network through that. So if you have only few edges which are bad, then the amount of things that can go wrong in your system is small. If you have more friends, you accept all the requests on Facebook, things you will just see much bad information, or much you will get very many bad links. So this is just a very simple way to look at the system in the similar way here. So in principle, this thing we can define as the edge cut, and the amount of badness that we can happen inherently depends on the edge cut. Okay, so in most application, introducing the node is much easier than the drawing the trust from the well-behaved node, and that's the assumption which allows us to differentiate between the well-behaved nodes and the Sybil node in such a system, and reduce any sort of wrongness that can happen. Okay, there have been several systems which are developed of this kind, and as we are talking about the payment domain, I will focus on the Ripple network, which is basically an online settlement network, employs exactly the same concept and is used by several players. Okay, So Ripple network is a credit network among participants, and they have trust which is flowing between all these participants. And there are banks all over the world which employ this. For example, these are the two examples from USA. There are examples from Germany, Spain, Australia, Singapore, all these banks. There are also, you don't have, because of the credit network, you don't have any limitation on one currency. Okay, some links can be in dollar, others can be in Bitcoin, others can be in euros, or some others can be Singaporean dollar, you name it. And then because of this such a system, you can have the transaction which goes and cut the boundaries across the currencies. And in principle, this Ripple networks, the key advantage that is applicable here is that you can convert one money to some other money. You can convert dollars to euro if it is allowed by the some participants in the network, as long as you are following the graph or you are following the path in the graph. So these are the systems, and basically a network is basically full of such values which all different links have different currencies on them, and you allow the intra-currency transactions. The reason why people started to use such a system is similar to the blockchain general scenario. Once you perform a transaction on a path, the transaction gets added to the ledger, that's it. It's a perfect transaction which will not get reverted. So the things such as remitting money, which we know takes days, at least a day, can happen using such a system just in the matter of few seconds. And there are banks which are using such transaction across different currencies, from Canada to Europe, and all these examples are already taking place. But as you can see, it also has a similar problem as the public verifiability that was present with the Bitcoin that we already saw. Okay, so before we move on, it's still interesting to understand the inherent difference between a credit network and a cryptocurrency like Bitcoin. And the differences can be looked into is that Bitcoin is actually currency. It's like other fiat currencies. It allows you to exchange one Bitcoin for other. It allows you to exchange money. While on other hand, a credit network is a transaction settlement network, which allows you to perform transaction across currency as long as there is a path exists from one user to the other user in the graph, and that path allows you to perform this transaction. Okay? While in Bitcoin, we do not need such path. It can happen between any two participants. So that's the trade-off there, that if you want multi-currency transaction, Ripple is better. If you want to stick in one scenario, maybe something like Bitcoin is better. Okay? And there are also, because of this whole path-based transaction, as it turns out, there is still a difference in the Bitcoin and Ripple in terms of the scalability, that multi-currency transaction can become highly scalable as compared to this one currency system like Bitcoin.
I have a question here.
Yeah?
So let's say people are, when they die, they are basically turning adversarial, because edges are turning red.
Yes.
Eventually everyone dies.
Yeah.
So all edges turn red.
Yeah. So
the whole, everyone is, so think of it in this way, like when someone dies, they are not going to pay any people back. The credit that people have, that is lost.
Yes.
So every edge which turns red is lost.
Yes.
So over time, let's say in 100 years, whatever edges we had today, everything will turn red.
Okay. I know what you understand.
So all the money is lost. Whatever we have, the network that we have today, after 100 years, all edges will be red.
Yes, so I understand what you're saying. So I'll not call lost. So the idea will be that like we give the inheritance to our successors, basically we are going to provide this as the inheritance successors in principle. So in principle, it need not to be lost, but you may, typically I think if it comes to the money, I think for the path-based payment, typically you will just cash in. You will try to reduce this links by zero by talking to this person and reducing the links to zero by actually cashing and converting that to fiat currency. That will be a more prominent scenario, but one never stops you from actually just giving the secrets as from one generation to the other. Similar thing with Bitcoin. I mean, there's lots of Bitcoin which get lost because people forget their keys. So, it's similar in one case. When you lose your money, somebody else is probably going to get it in the real world. But in this case, unless somebody accidentally steal it from you, if you create something, get money on that account, and then forget your secret, that's it. Your account is, that money is lost forever from the system. Yeah, you wanted to ask?
How can you transfer the bitcoins into actual money? Like, how do you, is there any way that from my bank if I have a wallet?
So there are well-known exchanges which allow you to do that, where you will go with the Bitcoin and they will convert that. They will, you can search online and there's a big list and they all will tell their own exchange rates. You can also use something like Ripple Network, where the idea will be with your bank. Now you have two link. One will be Bitcoin link and the other will be the some other currency link, and you can convert that via the same bank or via different banks as well. So there are different exchange capabilities. Rather, that's one of the inherent things system that people started to work immediately after coming with Bitcoin, that you want to exchange money from one way to other. Yeah?
So if there is an institute that exchanges currency for the Bitcoin, doesn't that, like, over time get a lot of Bitcoins? Because that becomes a monopoly, and then will that not destroy the network?
Yeah, but then idea will be typically they themselves also have to cash in somehow, so they are also going to distribute that. So eventually, there are people who have maybe more than 1 or 2% of Bitcoins with them, but not a lot. And eventually, they will also cash in. So as long as they started to own a significant amount of money, maybe we don't need to worry about. But if they started to own a really significant amount, like 20%, indeed things can go wrong very quickly.
So you said in a blockchain technology,
If a transaction is just about to happen from one party to another, does it get broadcasted to all the nodes in the network?
Yes.
So isn't that a breach of security? So if I want to send money to another party, but I don't want the other people to know about it.
Yeah.
It has to be broadcasted.
That's a good question. That's what we discussed earlier, that one way to do that is then you combine your transaction with others like you, so that they don't know who sent money to whom.
Okay.
But indeed, that's exactly the privacy challenge that we have in all this system, because the whole public nature of the logs, I mean, they have made log public for the because they want to show that they are doing things correctly. Okay. The privacy is an important and key concern here.
And your protocol is actually
My protocol allows us to actually combine your transactions such that you can send money to others, but at the same time you will remain hidden between a set of other guys who are performing transactions simultaneously with you.
Okay, thank you.
All right. So moving on, the key thing, however, which is same between the two systems, is this public logs that we already just mentioned about. And similar to what we observed in Bitcoin or in cryptocurrencies, here also we can use this public cloud to find out who transacted with whom, for what amount, what are the links they are used, how they are used. And because here we collect the money on the links, I'm not going to keep on creating thousands of links or thousands of accounts. So inherently, such a system is much more vulnerable to all this linking attack than the Bitcoin itself. So it's possible to link multiple transactions and identity belong to the same user, even in such a system. And this is obviously an assumed problem, but similar to the Bitcoin, there was no study which was performed already to actually demonstrate that this attack happens. And typically in the research or in the otherwise, privacy attacks are the one which you have to actually demonstrate the attack before people started to believe you. So it's innocent until proven guilty is the case for the privacy attacks. And then we wrote a paper recently which showed that indeed what all can you actually link and what all can you determine from this publicly available ledger for the Ripple transaction in general. Moving on, then the question is how we solve the problem in this space, because the similar problem exists in this in the case of the path-based transaction as well. Okay, so the idea is that similar to the Bitcoin, we want to combine different transactions. But we have one issue here. The issue is that if all these transactions taking different paths and the path do not coincide, then you can still determine who is talking to whom based by looking at the path in the part of transaction or afterwards. So instead, what we want here is that we not only want that they perform the transaction together, but their path should also coincide in at least one node. So as I'm showing here in the diagram, the idea will be we have different participants, they want to talk with some other participants, but now they can perform the transaction together as long as they have some party in between through which all their paths will go through. And now, for any observer who sees such a transaction having multiple senders and multiple receivers with all paths going through just one node, they won't be able to link which sender is talking to which receiver. Okay? They will just be able to see that some sender is talking to some receiver, but because of this intersecting path, they won't be able to obtain that information. And that's one way to achieve some privacy for this transaction. I mean, as I'm showing here with my example, I'm showing how the links will change. Basically, all the links on the left-hand side are reduced by 10. All the links on the right-hand side are increasing by 10. Okay? So some of you must have already seen, if my transaction amounts are not the same in these transactions, then you can just link the sender and receiver by the transaction values itself, here as well as in Bitcoin. Okay? So the inherent requirement is that the transaction volumes remain the same. But if you have enough participants who have the transactions which are of the same value or which have exact same values or very similar values so that they can maybe do some rounding, you can use such a system. Okay? So the path shuffle is the example that we saw earlier for the Bitcoin, and here, the coin shuffle is the example that we saw for the Bitcoin, and here instead we now shuffle the paths with each other and obtain the privacy. The way so that they can perform this with each other remain exactly similar to this squaring and raising idea that we saw with the dynamic cryptography network. And that's how they make the whole list, which is available from the right-hand side, basically all the right-hand side participants, and then they use that to perform their transaction together. So the key thing is that not only we find conceptual, both the earlier protocol as well as these new protocols are applicable in the current networks. And we actually just were able to take the current network as it is in the current form, and by making some minor modification, not to the network, but the way transactions are performed, we are able to perform the transactions, this path shuffle as well as coin shuffle that we saw earlier, on such a system. And we included those networks, and they are present in the current logs which are present on these systems. So this system is 100% compatible with Ripple, in this case, which is a great network. And we tested all that on the network successfully. And this can be now something which is ready to use. Ripple's network is slow in terms of acceptance, but in the on the Bitcoin system, they have already started to use the concept that is developed by us. So finally, coming to the interesting challenges, in the future, we have various interesting things that can happen. Okay, we have lots of challenges with the system we saw. I would say that in the smart contract, we are hardly yet utilizing the true potential of them. There are several things where we can introduce them and reduce the intermediary, which are making the procedure slow and resource constrained. There can be other better systems that we can develop for the privacy. However, I'd like to use this slide to actually talk about some other applications. For example, there is a concept of payment channels or Lightning Network. These are the networks which tries to combine the concept of credit networks and the concept of Bitcoin so that you can still perform transactions on channels much more faster, because we saw that the Ripple or the credit networks are faster than the Bitcoin network. But at the same time, we get the features which are similar to the Bitcoin, where the trust now relies on the trust system of the Bitcoin and not on the trust system of the Ripple for the blockchain. And then there are interesting challenges there, that how we achieve the security, privacy, and the applications there. We know from the internet that we don't call internet as a network, we call it a network of network. And if very soon we start to see that there are all these blockchain solutions that are present. Some are private, which are developed by some of the companies, some are public. And we will require a system where these ledgers or these blockchains have to talk to each other so that you can perform what is called as interledger transactions. And very interesting things to do there is that we can define a protocol which cut the boundaries across these ledgers and still allow them to exist in a manner they want to exist, locally or globally, but still allow the transaction across them. And this interledger protocol, there is already a WC3 community on this topic. But again, in all these interledger systems, we have to deal with the same issues as security and privacy. And it's very interesting to consider the solution that we have developed and shift them to this newer and other exciting domain. So in the end, the four key points that I like to mention here is that, as I mentioned earlier, we shifted in 90s from the local system to the global system in the form of Amazons and Airbnbs and Ubers. For the last around six, seven years, we are seeing a shift where rather than having a centralized system, we want to now develop a decentralized distributed systems which does not rely on individual entity or individual organization for the trust. And it seems very interesting that now these concepts can lead us to very interesting applications, not only in the payment industry, but also outside. Then we see that not only the payment scenario, but such systems can have applications outside. And we saw an example regarding NDA, a non-disclosure agreement contract, and how can we actually allow to replace arbitrators in such systems by the actual smart contracts in the Bitcoin system. Then we know the other examples. For example, there are issues in the sense that there can be problems with transaction linking in all such public systems. If the logs are public, people can link the transaction for you and determine who you are. And it's very critical and important problem to solve this privacy issue there. And in the end, we had a small discussion about what are the interesting challenges. So thanks a lot. And I'll be more than happy to have your questions.
Closures.
Yes.
How do you detect leakage, that sensitive document was leaked by receiver to someone?
That's a very good question. So the idea is that typically it's certainly something that we get outside. If you cannot detect that the document is leaked, if you do not have any way to determine that document is leaked, if you just think from the basic information in perspective, we cannot determine, we cannot know that something wrong has happened. So we cannot enforce such a system. Rather, I would make a claim that if you cannot determine the what is got leaked, we can't do anything there other than just rely on some other mediums which are completely non-technical. So it's an inherent assumption that we have to make that you know and you see the document that got leaked.
Okay. Yeah. If let's say we have a mechanism to detect leakage, and in the oblivious transfer concept, you said there are multiple versions of the same document.
Yes.
So document is same, but encrypted with 10 different keys.
Not encrypted. It's just it has a different version. It's like in one version you are going to use, you are going to add two spaces in some cases. In other cases, you are going to add. You are going to structure. You're going to write with a different style of English, other we are going to write in American style, in British style. So there are different techniques for watermarking which are present and you should employ such. But then the idea is that it should not be possible for the receiver to remove this watermark. So you want to keep your watermarking technique hidden. So the concept that is typically associated with this is called robust watermarking.
So then we assume that receiver cannot destroy the watermark. And there is a
without destroying the document.
And there is a money deposit which is made by receiver. So if sender detects leakage, then sender can withdraw the deposit.
Money. Yes.
And how is it done technically?
So the key concept there is that the document, this is just a simple way. Let's take that this secret of that receiver has is just one bit of information. Okay. You're going to create two versions. As a sender, receiver got one version, which is exactly depends upon the that one bit of information, one bit of secret that it has kept. Now, if you see the leaked document, you can differentiate whether it was the first version or the second version, or the zeroth version or the first version. And that allows you to determine what was the bit for the box or for the receiver. Now, if you just extrapolate that concept for the key size, so that you cut your documents in different parts, and then basically create two versions for each those parts of it. You can just extrapolate this concept so that now the receiver's whole private key can be revealed via this means.
Mm-hmm. So the receiver's private key is revealed by the fact which document receiver
yes.
has chosen.
Yes. Until receiver keeps his private key, keeps the document hidden, nobody can know that.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, it's interesting. Maybe we can take it offline. Can the receiver somehow falsify that I...
Mm-hmm. Yeah, let's talk more offline. But I see what you are heading.
Thank you.
Okay.
Any more questions?
Yeah.
So you said that there is a move to change the network from centralized to a decentralized.
Yes.
For example, the Bitcoin, isn't that a little bit dangerous? Like, because it's only used by, sometimes it can be used in a negative ways. Like, if there is no trusted party that actually can monitor, you know.
So you're talking about a key issue that we have to look at all this in system is the regulation.
Yes, you're saying there's a huge move that the whole system is transferring to a decentralized system. But
yeah, so the key thing is there's an interesting issue, and the key challenge is that government may still like to regulate that to a different level. Maybe not in a completely centralized manner, but still, if something wrong happens, they may want a capability so that they can go after some guys or determine something that. So there can be interesting solutions which can. So currently, the current system is completely decentralized. They don't want to allow that, but maybe in the future we may have system which will try to achieve both the privacy, decentralization, or maybe three things simultaneously: some regulation, while still maintaining the privacy and the decentralization. That's a very interesting challenge. But I would say that from the experience that I got, typically some central organizations give significant maliciousness or significant notoriety to the systems much more than their actual effect that we see in the real world. But while saying that, I know that it's still a very interesting thing to get the regulation, decentralization, and privacy simultaneously.
Yeah, because technically it's actually excellent, but on the other side it could be used in a...
No, but we can do better. We can maybe try to achieve both simultaneously.
Not at the moment, but later in the future.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Let's thank the
speaker. Yeah, thanks.